Hello, how are you doing? I'm feeling quite buoyant and optimistic today. I'm not really sure why that is. It might be partly a general mood of the country since things have been reopening in England again. So, like over the weekend, I was able to go out to eat with my partner, which is just a lovely, simple thing to be able to do again. Or it might have something to do with me being slightly sleep deprived. So, this might be a temporary mania that I'm having. But in general, I'm just really excited about these two big piles of new books that I have. And whenever I do one of these book haul videos, I finish it feeling so jazzed up and really excited to start reading because there are so many good new books coming out and not enough time to read them. That is just always the way. But one of the great things was that bookshops just recently reopened in England. So on the first day that happened, I went out book shopping and I bought a copy of Bitter Hall by Helen McClory. And Helen McClory is such an interesting writer. So this novel is about a group of flatmates in a northern city, and they're all quite different from each other. And the story revolves around a stolen 19th century diary by a gentleman who may not be completely dead. And that's a really intriguing sounding story. And yeah, her writing is so atmospheric and kind of dark in a way, but really psychologically insightful. She wrote a collection of short stories called Mayhem and Death that I thought was so fascinating. And yeah, Margaret Atwood wrote a blurb for that book of short stories where she described it as shiny dark licorice mind candy, nothing quite like them. And yeah, I love that description of it. And yeah, so really looking forward to reading this. The High Rise Diver by Julia von Lakato. This is about a world famous champion diver who has a very lucrative contract which she decides to break, and about an individual that is hired to rein her back into performing again. And this is, I think, slightly a dystopian novel. It's described as like a cross between The Handmaid's Tale and The Circle and Brave New World. It says at the top that Big Sister is watching you. The Intoxicating Mr. Lavelle by Neil Blackmore. This is just out in paperback, and it's the story of two brothers who go on a grand European tour in the late 1700s, and about their experiences and how they have a very different approach, in that one is very observant of societal norms and the other one is very rebellious against them. And this book begins with a quote from Jean Rhys, who I absolutely love. And it's, "If all good, respectable people had one face, I'd spit in it." And that's such a great quote to begin with. Liberty by Caitlin Greenidge. This is about a freeborn black girl named Liberty Sampson growing up in Brooklyn after the Civil War. And her mother has very different plans for what she wants her to do with her life, but she has different ideas about that. And so it's about that conflict and following her story as she grows up and progresses forward. The cover of this novel is so gorgeous, and yeah, I'm really looking forward to reading this. Boys Don't Cry by Fiona Scarlett. This is a debut novel. It's about a 17-year-old Irish white boy that has quite artistic sensibilities, but his father is a gang leader, and he tries to be a positive influence on his younger brother, but he finds that there are expectations set for him that run contrary to what he wants to do with his life. And so it follows his journey in that. And yeah, this sounds so good. I've been looking forward to this for a while. Now, from Boys Don't Cry to Male Tears. And this is a collection of short stories by Benjamin Myers, who, this is actually his debut collection of short stories. And I've read a couple of his novels before. I think he is such an extraordinary writer, and he explores the natural world and masculinity in such a fascinating way. So yeah, I'm really looking forward to getting stuck into some of his shorter fiction, which I think he's been published in over time, like over the past 15 years, and now it's come together in one collection. Another collection of short stories is Toddler Hunting by Taiko Kono. I've talked about this book before in a video at the beginning of this year about classics that I want to read over 2021, and this is a reprint of short stories that were first published in the 1960s in Japan and that explored female desire in a way that wasn't often written about at that time. And this collection comes with a new introduction by the author Sayaka Murata. So yeah, so exciting. This One Sky Day by Leon Ross. This is a big new novel with sprayed edges, all about a series of characters on a fictional archipelago and their intersecting lives with each other, but it's told in a magical realist style, and I just can't wait to get stuck into this. There was a really great review published in The Guardian of it, written by Michael Donker over the weekend, that made me really excited to get into it. Another book with a gorgeous cover is My Autobiography of Carson McCullers by Jen Shapland, and as it says, this was a finalist for the National Book Award. So the author discovered a group of letters that were written to Carson McCullers by another woman that were very romantic in tone, and this seems to open up a whole other side of Carson McCullers' life, which we didn't know all that much about before. And so she is writing a sort of biography of Carson McCullers, but also exploring the ways that we construct our lives, the ways that we are remembered, the ways that other people are memorialized, and how certain slants can be given to people's lives. And so I'm just so looking forward to reading this. Then I have a couple books that have a surprising common theme in that they are Westerners that travel to Japan and completely reinvent their lives while living there. So the first is called Fishtown by John Gerard Fagan, and this is a memoir, so he is a Scotsman that when he turned 30, he moved to Japan not knowing the language or what he would do there, and it's about his journey there and his experiences, which he recorded on his phone, and these are reproduced in a series that is sort of a travelogue, but also kind of poems about his time there. And so seems to have quite like an inventive form to it. And then the next book is a novel called Black Dragonfly by Jean Paisley, and this is a novel about a real Irishman that traveled to Japan in the late 1800s and wrote a number of books there and became a really famous writer. The writer was called Lafcadio Hearn, and is about his experiences there, and so it's a fictionalization of his life there. Olivia Lane is such a fascinating writer of nonfiction in how she writes about politics and art and fascinating individuals from the past, which she brings into the present to talk about current concerns. And she published a book of essays last year called Funny Weather. And so this just come out in paperback yet. Shamefully, I still haven't read it, but I'm looking forward to reading this. And she also has a new book called Everybody, which is about a number of different figures, including the psychoanalyst called Wilhelm Reich, and how he was such a controversial and interesting figure that was very progressive in some ways, but also really regressive in other ways, so had all these contradictions to him. And she explores all that while looking at the body and the physical being that we inhabit and the difficulty of doing that in the world. And this is a subject that Olivia Lane has written about a number of times before, but uses him as an example, but also figures as disparate as Nina Simone and Christopher Isherwood and Susan Sontag. So yeah, a whole fascinating range of figures. And yeah, like I said, her writing is just so fascinating and compelling and really gets me to think. This is another novel with a really beautiful and fierce cover called Of Women and Salt by Gabriela Garcia. And it follows five different generations of women across Cuba and America, and explores, it goes backwards and forwards in time, exploring their lives. I love multi-generational novels, and whenever I open a book and see a family tree, I get so excited. And this book, on the back of the book, has a family tree, so that sold me instantly, and I'm so excited to read this. Bear by Marianne Engel. This is a reprint of a kind of cult classic Canadian novel that I think was first published in the 1970s, and it's about a lonely librarian that lives sort of in seclusion, but that's disrupted one day when she goes to investigate and chronicle the estate of a mysterious man that dies on an island. So she travels to this island, cataloging his estate and his belongings and manuscripts, and finds there a bear that was left, and strikes up a kind of emotional relationship with this bear, I believe. It sounds so intriguing, and yeah, really looking forward to reading it. Fidelity by Marco Missaroli. The inspiration for this novel came when the author had a conversation with his father, where the father confessed that he had always been faithful to his wife, the author's mother, but he felt that this meant that he had to give up a part of himself. And that's quite a complex notion that a lot of people in long-term relationships have. So the novel explores a couple who both feel desires for other people which aren't consummated, but how that means they sort of sacrifice a part of themselves. And so it explores that notion, and which is quite a touchy subject, I realize, but I think is a really fascinating and endlessly compelling one. Listening Still by Anne Griffin. This is a novel about a young woman that has a gift where she's able to hear the voices of the recently dead and relay their last wishes and their revelations. But she feels very ambivalent about this gift that she has, and wants to start a new life for herself, but finds herself encumbered by the family business of being undertakers. It's about that conflict. And Anne Griffin is such an interesting writer. I read her debut novel, When All Is Said, which I thought was really powerful and fascinating. And really looking forward to reading this new Irish novel. Then I have a couple new books of nonfiction. So the first is The Seven Necessary Sins for Women and Girls by Mona El-Tahawi. And this is a feminist manifesto where the author identifies seven different sins that women are socialized to avoid, including anger, attention, profanity, ambition, power, violence, and lust. And so she describes in this how women and girls should defy, disobey, and disrupt the patriarchy. Sex Robots and Vegan Meat by Jenny Clegan. This is a book about how the author traveled to a number of different places to investigate some technological advancements that are meant to solve a number of different problems, like with sex, where she goes to a factory where sex robots are being produced, and yeah, really creepy and strange, but also about vegan meat and about birthing, where women want to have children without the actual physical experience of giving birth, but then also about people that want to choose the actual date of their deaths. So yeah, I think there is a lot of dark and disturbing things in this, but she explores it in a sort of humorous light. I heard the author read from this quite a long time ago and describe this book, and yeah, it came across as really funny, but also yeah, really dark and unsettling as well. Lessons in Love and Other Crimes by Elizabeth Chakrabarty. This is a debut novel about a woman that leaves her job under duress after she experiences a number of hate crimes, and how she wants to find a new life for herself, but finds that quite difficult. So this is partly based on autobiographical experience, and while this is a novel, it also includes some essays where the author is writing about her own experiences and trying to process these events. I have a couple new dystopian novels that explore sex and gender in a really interesting way. So the first is Andrea Vitrex by Laurenc Villalonga, and it's translated from the the Catalan by P. Louise Johnson. So this is a novel about a man in the 1960s that's frozen and he's brought back in 2050 in a future set time when family and gender have been done away with. And explores his journey in that. Then there is The End of Men by Christina Sweeney Baird. And this is a novel about a plague that sweeps across the globe and that mainly affects men and wipes out almost all of the men in the world. So then it's about what it's like going forward as a female-driven society. And there's been a number of books like this before, like The Power by Naomi Alderman and other feminist dystopian novels. And I'm really interested to see what this new take on it is. Line by Niall Bourke. This is a debut Irish novel that is a speculative fiction about a man, his mother, and his girlfriend, and how they've always obeyed the rules and fallen into line. But when his mother dies, he discovers a book hidden amongst her belongings, and that sort of inspires rebellion. I'm always excited to read new Irish fiction and really looking forward to this. I have a new collection of poetry called The Yak Dilemma by Supriya Kaur Dhaliwal. The author was born in India and moved to Ireland, and her poems explore how we're often driven to cross territories to forge maps of our own, and how our sense of home isn't necessarily defined by the four walls of a house. There's a new book by Jenny Lawson of autobiography/essays called Broken in the Best Possible Way, where she explores her experiences with depression and trying to overcome depression, but looks at it from humorous angles. And I've not read her before, but I've heard really great things about Lawson's writing. And I love how Caitlin Moran says that Jenny Lawson is the queen of saying too much. Ariadna by Jennifer Saint. There has been a number of retellings of Greek mythology, and this is another one, but it sounds really good, and I'm quite excited to read it. So Ariadne and her sister Phaedra grew up in a palace which has a labyrinth beneath it, inhabited by a minotaur that bays for blood. It tells her experience and her perspective growing up here and falling in love and trying to find a new life for herself. Under the Wave of Waiema by Paul Theroux. This is a new novel about a famous surfer that is in his 60s, living in Hawaii, that is sort of over the hill, but he's still massively revered by younger surfers in the area. And he gets involved in a drunk driving accident, which dramatically changes the course of his life. And so it follows his story from there. And I've never read Paul Theroux's writing before, but I've always wanted to try reading it. And I love the stories of surfers. I'm quite keen on this new novel. The Story of a Goat by Perumal Murugan. This is the story of a simple farmer living in India, who one day is approached by a mysterious individual and a giant who give to him a baby goat. And that baby goat grows up in a very accelerated and strange way. So it's a slightly fantastical story, but one that also explores social hierarchy and caste and race in modern day India. And then finally, I have a couple of books which sound like quite sort of lighter reads. A lot of these books sound like quite serious. I mean, there's some really good, but sometimes I'm in the mood for something slightly lighter. So the first book is a reprint by Virago of a classic detective novel called Poison for Teacher by Nancy Spain. And this is about two female detectives that go undercover at a school where some what first seem like pranks take a darker turn, and so they explore what's really happening behind the scenes. And I think it's meant to have quite like a humorous tone to it that just sounds quite fun. Then there is the novel The Summer Job by Lizzie Dent, and this explores the issue of wanting to leave your life and start a new life for yourself, which a lot of us quite often daydream about but don't actually do. And so the protagonist of this novel leaves her life to impersonate her friend and take her friend's job, working at a luxury Scottish hotel. But her friend is a world-class wine expert, and she is not. And so I think it explores that story in quite a humorous way. So just sounds like a lot of fun. So those are all the novels I want to talk about, quite a lot. But like I said, I'm really excited to get stuck into these now. And yeah, I need to go make myself another cup of tea because I am quite sleep deprived. I got up quite early this morning to watch the Oscars, which we recorded in the past. We stayed up all night watching the Oscars because obviously being in England, it takes place in real time in the middle of the night, but can't do that anymore. So just record it and watch it early in the morning. And yeah, it was really good. Nomadland is such a fantastic movie. It's so great to see it win a number of different awards, but also, yeah, a number of really fascinating, great films that I watched. Just watched Minari last night as well, which I thought was so fantastic. Such a touching and moving story, as well as the documentary Crip Camp, which was really fantastic. And it was great to see my octopus teacher win as well. And yeah, so many great films to watch, as well as good books to read. So hope you're doing well. Let me know in the comments and any of these books that you're really keen to read, or if you've read them yourself and want to let me know your thoughts about them, please do. So thank you for watching, and I'll speak to you again soon. Bye-bye.